Welcome, my name is Rob Sanders. I'm a course instructor at Simply Learn. Today we're going to talk about why you would want to rank using SEO. And SEO is search engine optimization, also known as organic search. You also may hear us say organic listings. But we're going to talk a little bit about why you'd want to rank your website in organic search. Okay, what is search engine optimization? Then we're going to follow that up with how does Google rank websites? So why does it rank one website over another? And how do we get our website to rank number one? Then we're going to talk about the different types of SEO or search engine optimization techniques so you can get your website ranked number one. And then we're going to finish that off with the do's and don'ts of SEO. So let's get right to it and talk about why SEO. So we're going to use a basic example, and let's just say you have a blog. You're a food blogger, you're passionate about food, and your niche is ice cream. And let's just say you have a lot of ice cream recipes. You want to get traffic to your blog. You want people to read your blog. And you're curious, why am I not ranking for my blog? Why, when people type in ice cream recipes and say Google, my blog posts don't appear at the top of organic rankings? And there's a number of reasons why you wouldn't be ranked for your blog post or your ice cream recipes. And the main reason would be your competitors. So there could be somebody else out there who is also passionate about ice cream and has been blogging along longer than you. And they have more content and more blog posts and more pages for Google to rank. So that's usually the number one reason. The other reason is improper usage of keywords. And we're going to talk a little bit, or it's actually a lot more about, you know, keyword usage in your content. So what kind of keywords do you want to rank for? That's really what we're talking about when we talk about usage of keywords. What keywords do you want to rank for, and how do we work those keywords into the content? Another reason is poor link building practices. And really that means, are other blog posts or other websites linking to you? Also, are you linking to other pages on your website? And so it's all about link building. And with link building, it's internal linking. So are we linking from one blog post to another? And it's external linking. Are other websites of high quality linking to us? And so that's what we talk about when we talk about link building. And then another reason is web page load time. So you could be running your blog post on, say, WordPress, for example, and your blog post isn't loading fast enough. Well, if you look at it this way, think about it, if you're Google, would you really want to rank a website or blog post in this example number one on Google rankings if that particular page loaded very slow? No, you wouldn't, because when somebody clicked on that link in organic search and went to your website, they're going to have a bad experience because the page is going to load slow. So Google doesn't want their users to have a bad experience. You don't want your users to have a bad experience. And so that's why web page load time is a critical factor for ranking. So we need to make sure that our web pages load fast. And then your user experience is not good enough. So Google, again, based on my example about the web page load time, Google wants people to have a good experience when they go from their search engine to your website. And there's a lot at play there, specifically web page load time, but also, you know, Google doesn't want any spam content. Google doesn't want any pop-ups or overbearing ads on the web page. They want people who are searching for something in particular, let's just say ice cream recipes, and they want to find a relevant website that has ice cream recipes. They want to be able to click on that link and read some good content about ice cream recipes. It's that simple. And that's really what Google's trying to create in their environment. And that's you as an end user, as a website owner, you want your users to have a good experience. And then last but not least, your website is de-indexed by mistake. And really what we mean is de-indexed is Google needs to be able to index all the pages on your website. So if you have a blog with 100 recipes, you want Google to have access to all 100 recipes. So we're going to talk a little bit later about how to get your pages ranked or indexed on Google Organic Search. So let's move on to what is SEO. So sticking with our ice cream blog theme, really SEO, search engine optimization, really is the practice of increasing your pages that Google has indexed up the rankings. So the end result is we want all our pages to be ranked number one for particular keywords. So if you want to be ranked for ice cream recipes, well, there's certain things you need to do. So that's generally how it works. We need to apply search engine optimization to increase a page for a keyword we want to be found for. So let me give you an example. So let's just say there's 100 students that participated in an essay competition. And so the competition in this particular case is evaluated on the basis of, is the content relevant? Are they using suitable titles for their essay? Do they have structure when they're participating in this essay or talking about the essay? And do they have a suitable synopsis? And is the content neat and readable? These seem all logical for an essay competition. Well, guess what? They seem logical for SEO because that's exactly how SEO works. It's exactly all those points I just mentioned about structure, logic, readability, organization, title. All those things are what's important in SEO. And so we need relevant content. We need titles for our pages. Google needs to be able to see structure. We need to have synopsis of what the page is about, and that's called the meta description. And then again, the content needs to be readable, and that's important. And so in order to be readable, again, we're gonna talk more about site speed because site speed's important. Okay. And when we talk about responsive design, when I say responsive design, that means your site, your page needs to load both on desktop and also on mobile. And so all these things are important. Just like an essay competition, Google is the judge and they need to be able to determine what page is best to rank number one, number two, number three, etc. on Google search. And then link building. Remember I mentioned link building a moment ago? Well, link building internally and externally also plays a vital role. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit later in the class when we talk about off-page SEO. How does Google rank websites? And basically, Google follows three basic steps to rank a website. They need to crawl your website. They need to take what they crawl back to their servers. And when they take it back to their servers, your web pages, they need to have them available for indexing. So when somebody actually types in a keyword into google.com, it'll be available to be found on organic search. So that's what indexing is all about. And then Google's job when somebody does type in a search query is to basically rank those pages that they've indexed from number one to infinity, depending on how many pages are relevant to that search query. So really it's about crawling, indexing, and ranking. So crawling is simply a process done by which Google has bots. And what these bots do is they go to your web server and they're going to crawl every page that they can find. And how do they find these pages? Well, they basically follow links. You might have heard the term spidering, but that's what they call search engine spidering. So basically what Google's doing is they're building a web, so to speak, all the links that they're following. And so when they can follow all these links on your website, they're going to be able to crawl them. And when they crawl them, basically they're going to take that content and store it on their servers so it's available in their index. So based on this method, Google finds out which websites have relevant content and which ones don't based on certain keywords that are typed into Google. Because if they can't crawl your website, you're not going to be found. And if you can't be found, then you're not going to show up for relevant keywords. So we need to make sure your site's available to be crawled. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. Okay, but let's show you an example. So let's just go to Google search. And if I type in the keyword simply learn, okay, I could see I have 1,010,000 results. Okay, and that's how many results are showing up for simply learn. Okay, now they may not all be simply learn pages, but nonetheless, simply learned is ranked number one here organically. And there are 1,010,000 pages related to the keyword simply learn. Now, when it comes to organic search, we don't want to get it confused with paid search. So anytime you see paid search, you're going to see something that says ad next to it. Okay, so we could see that there are paid ads here. But when it comes to organic search, those are generally below paid ads. And so that's where Google counts the 1,010,000 results. And so that's the whole idea behind crawling and indexing. Google's able to crawl Simply Learn's website, and based on all the pages that they gather, they're going to make those pages available in organic search. So if you type in a keyword and your web page is not available for indexing, then you're never going to show up for that keyword. So that's why it's important to make sure your website is available for crawling and indexing. And so when a user types a query on Google search, the most relevant websites that are in Google's index are going to appear in the search results. So in the example I gave with Simply Learn, well, Simply Learn is the brand name of the company Simply Learn. So there's a lot of relevancy there. So that's why you see Simply Learn show up here organically, number one. Like we mentioned about what is SEO and why SEO, we talked about that user experience. So there's a lot of factors that go into ranking, relevancy being one of them. So in the Simply Learn example, Simply Learn is relevant to a lot of the Simply Learn pages because that's who they are, Simply Learn. However, Simply Learn also needs to make sure that, you know, for their pages, the page load time is fast, meaning these pages load very fast for the end user. And Google also takes into account other factors, like how long someone is staying on a website, or are they bouncing, meaning are they going to one page that they land on and then leaving the website, okay? And so the user experience is very, very important. There are other factors also, like language and location. And so, for example, location, if you do a search, say in India, the results are gonna be a little bit different than, say, the results in the United States. Why? Because Google is indexing as many web pages as they can find. So if somebody's doing a search in India, their results may be a little bit different than the results show up in the US because Google has different bots. And these bots are crawling different pages at different times. And so Google's index is updating continuously, but it's not real-time syncing. So if you do a search in India, you may not see exactly the same thing because both search engines, the Google in India and the Google in the US, may not be exactly synced up. So an example would be, you know, if you're looking for cafe. So if you search a cafe in, say, San Francisco, you're gonna see different results. Now, if you do a search for cafes in Mumbai, you're gonna see different results. There's gonna be local search here at the top. There may be some paid search. But again, you may see different results because one, location, but two, Google search engines in India and United States, Google.com, aren't exactly synced up exactly at the same exact time you do that search. So location is important, language is important, and relevancy is important along with user experience. So all those are important factors in how Google ranks websites. Okay, so we're gonna talk about the types of SEO now. So if we wanna rank for a particular keyword on Google, we're gonna have to apply search engine optimization. And so there's two strategies to search engine optimization, on-page SEO and off-page SEO. So first we're gonna talk about on-page SEO. So on-page SEO is nothing more than optimizing your own website. And so when we say optimizing your own website, there's certain elements on your website and on your web pages that we need to take into account. And so some of those elements are headers, meta descriptions, title tags, linking. So all of those elements are something we can control as an end user who wants to rank our web page and our website on Google. And before we do anything with our website, the first thing we need to do is understand what keywords we want to rank for. In order to understand what keywords we want to rank for, we need to do keyword research. And if you do anything in SEO, keyword research is the most important activity. That's the most important thing you can do for SEO. And why do I say it's the most important? Because you need to understand, if you choose a keyword that you want to rank for, you need to understand how much traffic you're going to get from that keyword. If you're ranked organically, say number one on Google, so how much traffic will you get if you're ranked number one on Google? So you need to understand what the volume is. And then number two, we need to understand what the competition is for that keyword that you want to rank for. So if you choose a keyword and there's not much competition for it, then chances are you can rank for that keyword for a web page on your website quicker than, say, a keyword that has a lot of competition. So we need to understand those two basic factors, volume and competition, before we choose a keyword. And it's simply the practice of going through the motions of getting your volume and getting your competition data so you can choose the keywords you want. And then once you choose the keywords you want, then you can go and apply on page SEO. You can change the title tag, the meta descriptions, the headers. All those elements can be changed, but first you need to choose your keywords. And so again, the primary components we're looking for are how much traffic you can get or the search volume, how much competition there is for that keyword, and of course, relevancy. Okay, you need to be able to choose a keyword that's relevant to the web page you're trying to rank for. And so let me show you an example of how to go through this. So the first thing we want to do is we want to use a tool. And the tool I would recommend is Google Keyword Planner. And why do I choose Google Keyword Planner? Because if we're trying to rank on Google.com or Google search engine, we want to be able to get the data right from the source. So Google's going to be able to give us information about how much volume a keyword has and how much competition it has. So let me show you an example. So if I want to use Google's Keyword Planner and I want to rank for the keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist, then I'm going to type that keyword into Google's Keyword Planner. And what Google's going to do is they're going to give me some trends about how much volume this particular keyword gets over the course of a year. And so for that particular keyword, I can see that there are trends that appear for both desktop and mobile. So mobile is important because people start their search process a lot of times on their mobile device. So we want to be able to get data from mobile as well as desktop. And so we could see a trend here that for each particular month, over the last 12 months, we can see how much volume this particular keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist, gets per month. And so on average, over the past 12 months, I could see how to become a digital marketing specialist averages 30 searches a month. And this is on Google.com. And so Google gives us the volume. What they also give us is the competition. And so here I can see Google says for that particular keyword, the competition is medium. And so in the Google's Keyword Planner, what they also do is give me other relevant keywords that I might think about optimizing for, because you don't want to optimize for just one keyword. So how to become a digital marketing specialist, they're going to also offer up other types of keywords that are relevant. So just digital marketing specialist, social media marketing specialist. So for those keywords, I can see the volume. So for example, digital marketing specialist, I can see the average volume is 1,000 per month on average over the last 12 months. I can also see the competition is medium. But for some other keywords, I can see the search volume being high, like digital marketing course at 2,900 per month, but also the competition is high. And so what I would recommend as a best practice is to collect all your relevant keywords, okay, and put all your relevant keywords in a spreadsheet. And when you put all these relevant keywords in a spreadsheet, you wanna get the data on those keywords. And the data I'm referring to is the volume and competition. So in this case, we have volume from Google Planner, Google's Keyword Planner, and I have competition from Google's Keyword Planner. And so if I go into a spreadsheet and I put all that information in here, I'm gonna be able to see the volume and competition. And so that's important. However, one thing to note here is that Google's Keyword Planner, if I go back, just gives us low, medium, and high. And if I wanna compare numbers to numbers, maybe I want to be able to get exactly the competition number for the keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist. What I can do is go into Google and I can type in that keyword. So if I type in the keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist, I can see there's 76 million results. So I could see 76 million results, 76.1 actually, and for the keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist. Now that's a whole lot of results for this particular keyword, especially when the volume is only 30 per month on average. And so what I wanna do is get a more clear picture of the competition. And so what you could actually do is type in the syntax, all in title, and then colon, and then your keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist. And when I do that, I get a different result. Here I can see only 136 listings for how to become a digital marketing specialist. But that's not just 136, that's 136 with that particular keyword that we want to rank for in the title tag. Okay, so the title tag is what you see when you type in a keyword or search query in Google search, and the title tag is what you see at the top of every search result. And so now I can see I typed in how to become a digital marketing specialist with the all in title syntax. And now I can see every listing, every one of these 136 results have that particular keyword in it. So I could see every one of them, how to become a digital marketing specialist. And why is that important? Because now that tells me I only need to climb over 136 listings to rank for that keyword, how to become a digital marketing specialist. And so the idea here is you want to get your volume from Google's Keyword Planner, but you want to get your competition from Google Search. And again, that's simply typing in the syntax, all in title, and then your keyword. In this example, how to become a digital marketing specialist. Once you get those two numbers, you're gonna plug them in to your spreadsheet. And then once you do that for a number of different keyword queries, and these keyword queries, again, have to be relevant. Once you do that, then you can go in and pick the keywords you wanna optimize for. And that's important because, again, if you're not sure about a keyword, then you wanna do the keyword research so you can be sure of how much traffic you can get and how much competition there is. Those are three important factors in starting the process for on-page SEO. So, okay, you want to create content for, say, a keyword like digital marketing. But digital marketing may seem a little bit broad. So you wanna probably stay away from broader keywords because broader keywords tend to have a lot of volume, which is great, but they may also tend to have a lot of competition. But that's the whole point of doing the keyword research. Maybe it doesn't. Maybe there's more volume than competition. That's what you need to find out when you do the keyword research. You need to find those keywords that are relevant to your content that have a lot of volume and low competition. And then once we identify those keywords, then we are free to go in and start optimizing our web pages for those keywords. And the first place we want to start is the title tag. So if you remember my example, going back here to our search, how to become a digital marketing specialist, we saw that every one of these listings had that keyword in the title tag. And the title tag is important because that's what users who use Google search see first when they type in a query and get results. So they're gonna see the title tag. So the title tag is the most important element for on-page SEO. It's the most important factor because that's what people see. And so ideally when we choose our keyword, we wanna make sure that keyword is in the title tag because that's what shows up in Google search. And that's what makes that particular web page relevant for that keyword query. So the idea behind a title tag, it's between 50 and 60 characters. And so we wanna make sure we stay within that limit, no more than 60 characters, because what happens if it's beyond that, then Google will truncate the title tag. So if I go back to my search, you could see here on this particular title tag, Google truncated it, meaning they added the ellipses after the title tag because it exceeded the 60 character limit. So you wanna stay within those character counts. And so the title tag is the first place you should start when optimizing your website. Because when we have the right keyword in the title tag and somebody types in that keyword, then chances are it's gonna be relevant, they're gonna see it, and they're gonna click through to your website. And that's the whole idea behind ranking. We wanna get clicks. So that's how the title tag appears. So when you optimize it, you're going to update the title tag, and this is how it shows up. It's gonna show up at the top of your listing. Okay, and it's going to be bigger and bolder than anything else Google displays. So the second thing you want to optimize is the meta description. And the meta description is simply just a brief description up to 155. I would say about 155 to 60, 160 characters, but probably no more than that. And so the meta description is nothing more than a summary of the web page itself. So if I go back to my Google search results, I see my title tag and I see the page that this particular listing belongs to. And underneath that is where I can see my meta description. So in this particular keyword query, how to become a digital marketing specialist, I see. The meta description, an ultimate guide on how to build a career in digital marketing and the skills required to become a digital marketing specialist. Note that it's a well-written meta description with 155 characters, and it includes the keyword digital marketing specialist. So we're trying to rank for how to become a digital marketing specialist. And here you can see become a digital marketing specialist. So there's a lot of relevancy between not only the title tag and the keyword, but the meta description and the keyword. So when you're optimizing a keyword, you want to start with the title tag, but you also want to update the meta description. Because if you don't update the meta description and you leave the meta description blank, then you're leaving it to Google to add in copy that they deem relevant. And so for on-page SEO, we want to take control of the copy and we want to optimize it for the keywords we want to be found for. So the meta description is a powerful tool at our disposal. It gives us more characters to work with. It gives us more to talk about. So for that particular page. And so if the title tag is only 60 characters maximum, it's not a lot of information to try and get somebody to click. So the meta description helps us in identifying what that page is about in order to get the click. So the two working in tandem will hopefully increase your click-through rates. So when you're found organically, we want to get the click. And then the third element that's important is the URL. And URL stands for Uniform Resource Locator. And why is the URL so important? Because that's what people see. So if I go back to my search result, how to become a digital marketing specialist, notice that the URL also includes how to become a digital marketing specialist article. Okay, so it's very relevant. The URL is very relevant. One, we can see it in the search results. But two, you know, it's relevant to the keyword query. And that's important for the end user and Google. Google wants to know, hey, is this the page that's relevant to the user's query? And if it is, then this user's likely going to have a good user experience after they click on the listing. So the URL is an element that helps not only with the click-through rate, but with ranking. And having a poor URL structure doesn't help at all, because not only does Google not recognize the URL as being relevant, but the end user may not want to click on that page given the way the URL looks. So you want to try and avoid a poor URL structure. So the rule of thumb is this: if you don't understand what the URL is, then Google is likely not going to understand what the URL is. And so we want to try and keep our URL structures clean. And when I say clean, ideally you want to make sure that whatever keyword you're trying to optimize, that's the keyword that's included in the URL. Nothing included that is not understandable. So again, going back to our example, how to become a digital marketing specialist. It's very clean. The title tag is the keyword. The meta description is cleanly written, has the keyword. And then the URL is the other element that the end user can see. And that URL includes the keyword in it. So after we've done those three elements, the title tag, the meta description, and the URL, then we want to start optimizing the page itself. So ideally, when we say optimize the page itself, the page, remember, needs to be structured. And when we say structured, it needs to be structured in terms of, you know, headers and subheaders and organized in a manner in which the end user can read the article, read the content clearly and concisely without being confused. And so that's the job of headers. They add basically an organizational structure to the content. And with headers, there's a hierarchy. So you have anywhere from H1, which is the top of the hierarchy, to an H6. And so you're free to use any one of those headers when building out a page in order to organize the content. But ideally, you probably want to stick with an H1 or an H2, because those are at the top of the hierarchy. And what those do is they actually stress to Google that, hey, this header with this particular keyword in it is important. So if you use an H6 with the keyword in it, it's telling Google, hey, this is an H6, but it's not as important. So an H1 and an H2 tag show importance. And so let's look at an example of what that is. So here you could see an H1 is going to be at the top of the hierarchy. So that means it's going to be bigger and bolder. Then you have an H2, which is going to be bigger and bolder than an H3, but not as big and bold as an H2. So with headers, not only are you organizing the content accordingly, but you're also signaling to Google how important that particular header is. And of course, the header needs to include the keyword we're trying to rank for. So let's take a look again at that example. So if we go to how to become a digital marketing specialist, if I click on that page, I can look at the content and I can see that there are headers in here. So the headers are there to organize the content. And that's what we want. We want to be able to organize the content. And if you look at the other example I'm showing here, how to become a digital marketing specialist, learning paths explored, you can see that's an H1, but below it's a subheader, the growing digital marketing job market. So that's an H2. And so we're not stressing to Google that that's more important than an H1, but nonetheless, we're stressing to Google that it's important nonetheless. So we want to be able to use headers. We want to be able to use keywords in our headers in order to stress to Google what's important, and also to organize the content, because Google likes content organized. Okay, the next element we want to focus on is internal linking. And so internal linking, if you remember earlier in the presentation, is basically links from one page on your website to another. And so here we can see on this particular article, how to become a digital marketing specialist. There's also links to other pages on Simply Learn's website. And so for this particular content, it also links to SEO specialist, PPC specialist, social media marketing specialist, and digital marketing specialist. So the whole idea behind internal linking is to link from one page to another where it's relevant. And in this case, it's relevant because we're talking about how to become a digital marketing specialist. That's what the whole content is about. And so what Simply Learn's doing here is offering up other pages on their website that are relevant to becoming a digital marketing specialist. And so this is a best practice when you're optimizing a web page. So you want to be able to have internal linking on your site. And the whole idea behind internal linking is it also allows users to navigate through the site naturally. So when I say naturally, they don't always have to refer back to the top navigation. They can naturally and seamlessly go from one relevant article or page to another. And so that's the whole idea behind link building and internal link building. It allows Google to identify, you know, pages that they want to crawl and index because they're linked to one another. But it also helps the end user because it allows the end user to go from one page to another. And it's signaling to Google, hey, this particular page is linked to this page. So we're going to also index that page. And so that's the whole important part of internal linking. It's about the end user experience, and it's about allowing Google to find the pages on your website so they can crawl them and index them so you can be ranked for them. And so also, in addition to internal linking, we want to be able to use natural language. And so what do I mean by natural language or natural language processing? So what Google does is, in terms of natural language processing, they're looking for the content and the keyword. It needs to be relevant. So when your website is about digital marketing, you don't necessarily want to rank or try to rank for the keyword digital marketing. One, it's too broad. Two, there might be some competition. But three, you're probably not going to write something as broad like digital marketing. So ideally, what you want to do is you want to choose other relevant related keywords that's going to be more natural. And so that's what we mean by natural language processing. We want to choose keywords that are more natural to the content you're writing. So instead of the keyword digital marketing, maybe we want to talk about the types of digital marketing, or digital marketing examples, or what is a digital marketing strategy, or how to become a digital marketing specialist. So those are all relevant keywords to digital marketing and more relevant to the content. Because if you try to rank for the keyword digital marketing, again, it's probably going to be a little bit broad, probably more competition, and not as relevant to your content. And as a result, probably not a good user experience. So think about some other keywords that you could optimize and rank for. And that goes back to the keyword research. That's why the keyword research is so important, because it allows us to identify other keywords in the natural language process. What keywords are more relevant for the content? And then another element to on-page SEO is the sitemap. And so with a sitemap, it's basically a list of all the pages on your website. And the whole idea of listing all the pages on your website in one document is it helps both users and search engines understand the structure of your website. So there are two types of sitemaps. One's an HTML sitemap, and that's designed for humans. So if you have a website with a lot of content, at the footer or the bottom of your web page, you probably want to have a link to sitemap. So if somebody clicks on that sitemap, they're going to be able to see all the pages on your website, structured in an organized manner. Well, an XML sitemap, and XML is just a different format, it's designed for crawlers. And so the whole idea, remember, is Google likes to crawl content. When they crawl content, they bring it back to their servers and index it. And so we want to be able to create a sitemap for Google or other search engine crawlers. And so XML is the format. So let me show you an example of how that looks. So if I go to simplylearn.com and simply type in, say, sitemap.xml, just as an example, I'm going to get this particular page. And this particular page displays two XML sitemaps. So these sitemaps are there for Google to go ahead and crawl, and nothing more than a list of all the pages on your website. And so this is a quick and easy way for Google to get a hold of all those pages so that they can index them. And that's the whole idea behind SEO. You want to be able to have Google index all the content you want to be found for the keywords you want to be found for. So it all starts with the sitemap. So let's go from on-page SEO, which in recap is basically optimizing certain elements on your website so that you are relevant for a particular keyword. And that meant updating the title tag, the meta description, the URL, the headers, choosing the right keywords to put into the content, having internal linking, and also updating the sitemap. Well, those are elements that you can do on your website. So we're going to switch gears and talk about a different strategy, off-page SEO. Because without on-page or off-page, you can't have a page ranking. So the two work together. So you can do as much as you want on-page, but you still need off-page SEO. And you could do all the off-page SEO you want, but you still need on-page. So both of these strategies have to be in full effect in order for you to rank. So let's now switch gears to off-page SEO. And so off-page SEO is simply the process of linking or promoting your website using link building. And so if you remember, I talked about this earlier on. There's two types of links, internal and external linking. And so for on-page SEO, we used internal linking. For off-page SEO, we're going to talk about external linking. And external linking allows us to improve our website's recognition or relevancy or credibility. And why do we want to improve our relevancy and credibility and trustworthiness and authority? Because we want Google to know that our web page is trustworthy. It is recognized by other websites, and it is relevant for a particular keyword. And so if we can do that using off-page SEO methods, then Google's going to rank our web page for the keyword we want to be found for. So it's really off-page SEO is synonymous with link building, and there's plenty of opportunities to do link building. It just comes down to creating a strategy. So again, some of the benefits to off-page. Well, we talked about, you know, being credible and trustworthiness and relevant. We need to do that in order to rank. But there's some other benefits there. So if we have a link on another credible website, then it's likely going to increase the traffic to our own website. It also creates high domain authority. And so what I mean by high domain authority is if we have basically links to other web pages pointing back to us, then basically our domain authority is going to improve. And when our domain authority improves, other websites are going to want to link to us. So the higher authoritative we are for our website, then other web pages are going to want to link to us. And so the more external linking we have, the higher the domain authority. So it all starts with linking to other high domain authority websites. So linking to a high domain authority website, for example, having a link on Wikipedia that points back to our webpage creates high domain authority for us, and it helps drive traffic. So some of the other benefits of off-page SEO are credibility. So if we're linking from Wikipedia to our webpage, it does create credibility for us. It also helps us increase our page rank. So remember that external linking helps build domain authority, helps build credibility, trustworthiness, and it's going to in turn help us rank for that particular page. And then certainly not last, having a good off-page SEO link building strategy increases our brand awareness. Because if we're on other high authority websites, Wikipedia, or say a social platform, it's going to increase our brand awareness. And increasing our brand awareness increases our trustworthiness. And so if somebody is looking to, say, become a digital marketing specialist, then likely instead of typing in digital marketing specialist on Google, they may type in our brand name, in this case, Simply Learn. And so these are all the benefits to off-page SEO. So it's nothing more than having links on other websites that are pointing back to ours. And again, there's lots of benefits. It helps drive traffic and increases our authority. So those are things that we want to take advantage of when we want to rank. And the key behind off-page SEO or link building is always going to be content. So from an on-page SEO perspective, having quality content allows that content to be optimized for relevant keyword and ranked. But also from an off-page SEO strategy, having high quality content allows us to have other sites, and it doesn't necessarily have to be a website. It could be a social platform, or it can be another blogging platform or blogging website, link back to ours. Why? Because the content is original, it's natural, it's well-structured, it reads well. And so that's the whole idea behind off-page. You can't have links on other websites if you don't have quality content. So one of the ideas behind off-page SEO is not only do you want to create good content, but you probably want to spend a lot of time or a bit of time on others' websites. So remember the example I used earlier in this presentation about having an ice cream blog and ice cream recipes? Well, it probably wouldn't be a bad idea to say spend some time on other blogs related to desserts, related to cakes, related to food in general, related to vegetables or other items that people could link from. So the whole idea is understanding who else is out there, who has relevant content that you could share. So you could share your content with them, they can share their content with you. And generally that's how it works naturally anyway. In the web sphere, if somebody likes your content, they're gonna link to it. They don't necessarily have to wait for you to ask them. But it might not be a bad idea to understand who else is out there that has content similar to yours so that you can, you know, get a link on that particular website or blog post. And so some other ideas behind having external links pointing back to your website is social media. So social media is not just Facebook or Twitter, but it expands beyond that. There's Quora, there's Medium, there's all sorts of content generated websites like Reddit. So the list goes on and on. You just need to find what's relevant for your content. If it's relevant for your content, then it's worth putting or trying to get the external link on that social media platform. And then again, going back to my ice cream blog recipes blog post, yeah, if you find a particular blog that you want to have an external link on, there's nothing wrong with reaching out to that particular blogger. You know, in some cases, very flattering, but in other cases, if the content is relevant, then why not? It's only going to help your end user experience. If you add somebody who has, a blog about cakes, having their link on your blog post. So there's nothing wrong with it because it also adds to the user experience. And if you're gonna ask somebody to put an external link on theirs, you might want to be open-minded and make sure that you are able and willing to put an external link on your blog post or website pointing to their content. That's how the web works, especially if the content's of quality, relevant, and of good nature. Okay, so let's move on and finish up with the do's and don'ts of SEO. So we talked a lot about why SEO, what is SEO, you know, how do we rank for SEO, you know, what is on-page SEO, what is off-page SEO. And so Let's just wrap up with some of the things you, again, want to do to rank your page for a particular keyword and some of the things you don't want to do. So the first thing on the list is optimize for white hat techniques. And what I mean for opting in for white hat techniques is basically everything I just mentioned today. You want to do keyword research. You want to choose a natural language processing format, so you could choose keywords that are going to be relevant, natural to the content. And you don't want to opt for black hat techniques. And black hat techniques are probably not even worth going into detail, but one example is choosing a keyword arbitrarily, like say digital marketing, and just stuffing that keyword into the content. So that's probably not something you want to do, because again, it's not going to be good for the end user. So stay away from black hat and focus on some of the techniques we talked about in today's presentation. The other do we want to do is get backlinks from relevant sites. So that's off-page SEO. Again, it's what I mentioned earlier. It's about linking your quality content to another person's website that also has quality content. We don't want to have a backlink from an irrelevant site. Why? Because it's not going to be relevant, and it's also going to hurt our authority. Because if it's on a site that's not of good quality, then Google's going to look at us and say, well, this site is linking to your site, but it's not relevant. So therefore, you know, we're not going to look at you in the same way as if you were on a quality website. We do want to use our keywords naturally, because title tags are what people see first on organic search. But you don't want to use the same title tag on every page of your website. So we want to stay away from doing that. So you want to have a unique title tag for every web page on your website. And ideally, what does that mean? That means using our keyword research to choose one to two keywords per page and optimizing your web page for those one to two keywords. So you ideally, what you want to do is have one to two different keywords for every page on your website. We definitely want to write engaging content. So the content should be engaging. Remember, user experience. We want users to stay on our website. We want them to enjoy the content that they're reading. And we want them to go from one page to another naturally. We definitely don't want to leverage or plagiarize or just copy content from others' websites, because it's not, one, probably going to be relevant to what you're writing about. Two, it's duplicate content and it's somebody else's. So that's a black hat technique we want to stay away from. I can't emphasize this enough. We need to do keyword research first before you do anything else. You need to find relevant keywords. And not only that, you need to understand the volume and the competition for each of those keywords. Okay, you don't want to choose a keyword that has low volume, high competition. You want to choose a keyword that has high volume, low competition. But above all, you want to choose keywords that are relevant to your content. We want to avoid keyword stuffing, so don't take a keyword and just stuff it everywhere on the page. It's not going to be natural, and Google's going to be able to pick up on that. So we want to maintain some level of quality with our content and quality with the keywords that we choose. So reminder, when you have quality content, it's always going to link internally to another page on your website with quality content. But it's got to be natural. And don't just build site-wide backlinks, meaning don't just have an internal link to the homepage, or don't have every page on your website linking to just one page. So internal linking should be natural, naturally linking from one page to another. Not only does it help Google understand and crawl all the web pages on your website, but it's good for the end user. It's good user experience. And certainly last, but something I didn't talk about, does take time to rank your content. So remember the process. You're going to write your content. You're going to choose keywords. You're going to change the elements on that page for those keywords. And all the while, you're going to make sure Google can crawl that content. And when they crawl it, they're going to index it. The process takes time, especially if you choose a keyword that's competitive. So just be patient. If you have quality content and you've optimized for on-page SEO and off-page SEO, then you will rank for that keyword. And then make sure your website's user-friendly and mobile-friendly. So we talked about responsive content earlier. So remember, most users today start the process of search on mobile. So we want to make sure your websites are mobile friendly. So I want to thank you for joining me today. I look forward to seeing you on other Simply Learn presentations. So thank you for your time. And for more information, please feel free to visit simplylearn.com. Thank you.
Hi there. If you like this video, subscribe to the Simply Learn YouTube channel and click here to watch similar videos. To nerd up and get certified, click here.